I know we've been through a lot together,
but this is going great. I told you it would be fine.
Not so fast. I mean, it's just starting, and they have to know that that's a rotisserie chicken.
No, it's fine. Look, we've got everybody's Thanksgiving favorites, including gluten-free options for Aunt Barb. And look, everybody's having a great time, and no one has started talking about politics yet.
This is great. This food is amazing. Thanks so much for hosting Thanksgiving dinner.
Of course. Thank you guys for coming. This was so much fun. I mean, I'd even host Christmas.
This week, Martha and I are going to make our way to Florida to be with my family for Thanksgiving. And so right now, we have a little under 60 in our immediate family. That's my parents, siblings, their spouses, their kids, and their kids' kids. So there'll be four generations of Crothamels. There'll be 40 of us in one house on Thanksgiving Day. So I can tell you that all of the feels will be present on that day for Thanksgiving. Big personalities, little kids running around, fighting with each other, and you know, doing their little temper tantrums. There may be some adults doing that too. I don't know, but there'll be a lot of laughter and just a lot of emotion. Me talking that way, some of you are like, oh, that would be so much fun. That would be so exciting. And then some of you are like, no, I'd be in a corner curled up in a fetal position or something in that environment, right? But it'll be fun. It'll be exciting to be down there. And this week we conclude our series, All the Feels, and talking about emotions. And we're making our way to our upcoming Christmas series that'll start next week, and I'm excited about that. But I just have to tell you, this series has been kind of a teaser as to emotional health. We've just hit the top of the tip of the iceberg on this topic. It is massive. And in four short weeks, we have not been able to get into a lot of stuff. So I will tell you, as we jump into 2022, we will hit this in different ways, because this is so important for the health of this body we call Seven Marks and the church at large. And so I want to start today by going back to the statement that we made in the very first week. And it's this: you and I cannot be spiritually mature followers of Jesus while remaining emotionally immature. We all have this emotional gauge on the dashboard of our life that is giving us important, really significant information about us. And we have to pay attention to that if we're going to grow into the people that God desires us to be. And we're all image bearers. We have all of these emotions, happiness and sadness and calmness and anger, right? And we have anxiety and we have hope and despair, all of the emotions, and they come out all over the place in how we view ourselves and how we relate with other people and even how we communicate with our Heavenly Father. And then we also learn that we have some baggage from our families of origin, right, from our past, some good stuff, some bad stuff. We just bring it with us, and our past has shaped our future, or our present, rather. But what we learned in that week is if we go back and try and understand our family of origin and why we carry some of the stuff we carry, and even in some cases forgive those in our past, then we are able to move into the future. Our past doesn't have to shape our future. But then as we move forward, and last week we learned from Tyler, right, that we all have to come to grips with the fact that we have limits. And that's a good thing. In fact, it's a God thing that we understand and embrace that we have limits because we were created in His image. The key word there is created. We are not God. We are not all powerful. We are not all knowing, right? We're not infinite beings. And so it's important for us to understand that we have limits and to embrace them. To embrace limits in our life is to open ourselves up to God's grace for us, His limitless grace. And so in our weakness, and we all have weaknesses, we all have limits, right? In our weakness, God is able to showcase His power because our life is not about pointing people to us, right? Our life is about pointing people towards our Heavenly Father. And so when we started this series, one of the practices in week one was we encouraged you, okay, either at night or in the morning, take some time, like be quiet, get in some solitude, and start to debrief your day. If it was in the morning, then the day before. If it's at night, that day. And try and capture an emotion or two. And just kind of see how you responded, what it said to you. And I don't know if you have done that throughout this series. I will tell you that I have. And even in this past week, I have been able just to sit, like yesterday morning. I'll give you a prime example. Yesterday morning, I had no idea what the day was going to bring. And by last night, Martha and I had purchased a home for an investment opportunity. Piece of junk home in Wake Forest, in the old part of Wake Forest. I had no idea that was going to happen yesterday. But just so you know, there are every single day, you and I will encounter something that will require emotional health. But here's the question, and here's a series of questions that we're going to wrestle with today. How do we know if we are becoming more emotionally healthy as followers of Jesus? How do we know that? How do we know if we are making progress? Because you and I both know, in most areas of life, we can determine whether or not we are making progress. There are benchmarks, there are deliverables, there are measurables. Like if you're a runner, you can see, am I able to run further or faster or lifting weights or doing laundry or just sales calls, even revenue for your business. There are ways that you can tell if you and I are making progress, but sometimes it's hard to see whether or not you are making progress in this area of emotions. Now, I know that I have a lot of work to do in this area on myself, but how do I know if the work that I'm doing is moving me in the right direction? How do you know if the work that you are doing in this area is moving you in the right direction? The answer to all those questions may surprise you. And it's this: we will know by how well we love. Now that may surprise you. The hallmark of emotionally healthy spirituality is love. Emotionally healthy followers of Jesus get better at loving others. They get better at loving others. Now you're like, well, wait, hold a minute. So Paul, are you telling me that the answer to how I'm doing with this short fuse that I have with my anger, the answer to my how I'm viewing myself, my lack of self-esteem, the answer to the fact that sometimes I'm wrestling with depression, are you telling me that the answer to all of that is how I love? Yep, that's the answer. Now, like as you're processing that and sitting with that, maybe even pushing back a little bit, let's unpack this a little by looking at the one, the who, that is our point of reference, and that is Jesus. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn to Matthew chapter 22. So Matthew 22, and there's this scene where you have these religious leaders that are coming at Jesus, and they're asking him questions. And it's not that they're interested in what he has to say or in the truth. What they're trying to do is trick him. So there's one wave of religious leaders that come, the Sadducees, they come through, and Jesus silences them with his answers. But then they tag out, and another team tags in, and then there's one who asks Jesus the question. They want to know what Jesus believes to be the most important commandment. And without even flinching, Jesus just rolls right into it, and he quotes a verse out of Deuteronomy chapter 6, one of the Ten Commandments. And he says this in Matthew 22, verse 37. And he said to him, this person who was asking him the question, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment." And so they were tracking with his answer. They were familiar with the laws, particularly this law they were very familiar with. And it was like, yeah, Jesus, like everybody knows that. But then Jesus continued by adding another phrase from Leviticus 19, 18. And I don't know if this was like the small print, you know, what maybe the religious leaders kind of glossed over, like we gloss over some small print. We just want to get the highlights. So maybe it was like that for these religious leaders. I don't know. But regardless, what Jesus does is he elevates this next statement to be equal with the first statement. And he says this, and the second is like it. Verse 38, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Second is like it. Like it means in the original, exactly. This is exactly like the first one. "You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend everything, all the law and the prophets." So Jesus responds with the fact that the most important commandment in the whole Bible is not just one. It's actually two. Love God and love people. For Jesus, you can't do one without the other. And attaching your heart to both demonstrates that you're a follower of Jesus. Emotionally healthy followers of Jesus get better at loving others. This is the first time that we know of where someone combined those two Old Testament passages in this way. It was a radical answer from Jesus. So the Jews knew about loving God and they knew about loving others. But in their mind, they were disconnected. They were disconnected from one another. And we know that because in Luke's account, they follow with a question. And they say, well, okay then, well, who's our neighbor? And then Jesus responds with the story of the Good Samaritan. Samaritans and Jews hated each other. And so they were trying to discern, like, what is he talking about? Because not only did they think they were disconnected, they viewed that loving God was way more important than loving people. Which means I can love God even if I don't have the people thing all together, even if that's a work in progress. But what Jesus is saying here is that both matter equally. That was a radical teaching, and you can't do one without the other. Your love for people, my love for people, is an expression of my love for God. And it's an expression of how we are doing emotionally. Emotionally healthy followers of Jesus get better at loving others. So fast forward to a conversation that Jesus is having with his disciples. This is on the night he was betrayed before he would go to the cross. And so he has all of his disciples together at this table in the upper room. And it was at this meal that Jesus gave his disciples a new command. And John tells us what he said. In fact, if you want to sit, and I want to encourage you to do this maybe this week, because we're going to be around tables this week at Thanksgiving. But if you want to just kind of sit with the longest passage in Scripture of what happened at that meal, it's in John. It's in the Gospel of John. It's 13 through 17. So I would encourage you just to practice this week, sit with that, and just see all of the emotions and the activity of that table. So Jesus is at this table. It's in the middle of the meal. Judas has already left that he's going to betray him. And Jesus says this in John 13, verse 34, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another. And I don't know, disciples are like, Jesus, like, that's not a new command. We know that. But then Jesus continues, just as I have loved you, you also ought to love one another. By this, all people will know. They'll know that you're my disciples if you have love for one another. And then a few hours later, Jesus would demonstrate what kind of love he was talking about. Not this self-preservation type of love, but this self-sacrificing love when he went to the cross and he died for all of mankind. Emotionally healthy followers, they get better at loving people. They love like Jesus. Love for God and love for people are like two sides of the same coin. You know, if you've been at church any length of time, right, we know this. We could go into the New Testament and we could go to verse after verse after verse after verse, and we can find that the language of love is that's what followers of Jesus speak. We know that. It's not the fact that there aren't enough verses that tell us about love in the New Testament. The problem is that we still operate much like the religious leaders that were questioning Jesus. We live as if we believe that love for God and love for people are not connected or inform one another. That's how we live. So our three values at seven marks, right? We to elevate Jesus, to love people deeply, and to bring the kingdom of God near. And they're all interconnected. So when I start talking about love for God or elevating Jesus, there are a lot of amens in the room. A lot of amens. Yes, absolutely. When you talk about love for people deeply, I'm not sure. We believe that, but that's a different story. But if we're going to take Jesus seriously and what he said, then our love for people says a lot about how we actually love God. Jesus' half-brother John, at one point thought Jesus was crazy, but in the end, we read this. This is what he says in 1 John 4. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest. It was revealed among us that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we have loved God, but we were incapable, but he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. What does that mean? Well, because of our sin, we deserve the punishment, the wrath of God, because we are sinners. But God loved us so much that he sent Jesus, and he satisfied the wrath of God, and he made us right with God when we put our trust in him. So he is the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved, if God backed up the dump truck of love and dumped it on us, so also we ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. It's made mature. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, watch, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. Pretty strong words. We say we love God. That's pretty easy. It rolls. I mean, everybody says that. Even people that don't love God say they love God. It comes off the tongue easy, but it's much harder to love people. Why? Because we're imperfect. Because we're annoying at times. We're fallen, we're broken, we're difficult. We don't always deserve it. And we always don't receive it back. And so what happens, we bail out and we give ourselves a pass that we really don't have to love people, especially people that are hard to love. But we don't get a pass. As followers of Jesus, we don't get a pass as to whether or not we love people. No distinctions here. We need to be intentional and make an intentional choice to love others and put practices in our life that help us love others. Scazzaro, who is a guy we've quoted often in this series, he writes this: telling people to love better and more is not enough. They need practical skills incorporated into their spiritual formation to grow out of emotional infancy into emotional adulthood. The want to has to be followed with some practices in our life. But before I get practical, and I'm gonna give you three practical ways where we can jump into that this week. But before I get there, I have to talk about the key to all of this. And Tyler actually set the table last week for what I'm about to say, talking about the limits that we have. To become emotionally healthy as a follower of Jesus is impossible without first surrendering to the work of the Holy Spirit in you. It's impossible. It's Mark 3, seven marks, that a disciple is one who responds to the Holy Spirit. What we're talking about is supernatural in nature. You and I cannot do what we are called to do as a follower of Jesus without the Holy Spirit. Like, let's just go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the love chapter. It's read at weddings, and if you're not familiar with that chapter, the Apostle Paul talks about love this way. Love is patient. It's kind. It doesn't envy or boast. It isn't rude. It doesn't insist on having its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. Now, I don't know about you, but if that describes the kind of love that a follower of Jesus is to have, I need some help with that. Personally, I need some help with that. And the help is the Holy Spirit. In fact, he's the one that does it through you. Galatians 5, 22 and 23 says this: but the fruit, right, the demonstration, the expression of the Spirit is love. That's where it comes from the Holy Spirit living out of you. It goes on: joy, peace, patience. Didn't we just read that in Corinthians? Love is patient. It's kind. That comes from the Holy Spirit living out of you. I was sitting at a table this week with a couple, and the woman said, I just want him to be nice. I just want him to be kind. Is that too much to ask right now? And I thought, well, sometimes without the Holy Spirit, that is too much to ask, right? But that's what we get when we have the Holy Spirit: goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Man, those verses just ooze with emotional health for a follower of Jesus as they're surrendering to the Spirit. It's interesting to me, if you look back to the conversation I was talking about a minute ago, where all the disciples were sitting around this table with Jesus, this dinner table. And so he gives them this new command, you love one another as I love you. And then a little bit later in the conversation, he says, like, I'm going to leave you, but I'm going to give you, I'm going to send you a helper. I'm going to send you someone else just like me, the comforter. He's going to be with you. He's going to teach you everything. He's going to teach you the skills, how to be quick to hear and slow to speak, how to be angry with people and not sin against them, how to mourn and how to resist gossip and put away jealousy. And the list could go on and on. You and I have a teacher within us that helps us with all of that, that helps us with all of those skills as we put different practices into our life. So let's get practical. Let me just give you three things this week that you can work on. We're gonna be around a lot of people this week for the holidays, some of us, and so I wanna give you three practices, and there are a lot more, but these are three that will get us going in the right direction. First one is this: practice being fully present with people. Practice being fully present with people. Most of us struggle with people because sometimes we view them as just an interruption or a distraction to whatever has our attention. Sometimes I do this with Martha. The person that I love more than anybody else on the planet. But there are times where she's talking to me and like, I don't know. I'm thinking about something else. I have my phone or whatever. But what I'm demonstrating to her, either intentionally or unintentionally, is that life revolves around me. Whoa, easy, calm down. Man, there was a lot jumping on that in a minute. But unintentionally, what I'm saying is she's less than. And so what happens when we take this posture or position that we are more than or higher than? What we do is we discard people and we judge people and we mistreat people and we close ourselves off to them. In other words, we devalue people. Jesus didn't seem to struggle with that. When we look at Jesus in the New Testament and his interaction with people that came to him, man, we see a man that was dialed in. He was dialed in and he was fully present. He didn't seem preoccupied or distracted or judgmental or condescending or even appeasing. And he didn't because of the value that he placed on that other person. They were his priority. My bet is that most people, when they interacted with Jesus, maybe except for the Pharisees, they felt that they were the only one on the planet. That's how Jesus interacted. He was other-oriented. He came to seek and save the lost, to serve the served, or to serve, not be served, to love. People will know that we love them when we are dialed in and when they experience what Henry Nouwen called a healing presence. When we are a healing presence to people where we're contributing to their health spiritually, emotionally, and physically. So let's talk just about a couple ways that we can do that. Put your phone down. I don't know. I'm sure in your phone it tells you, you know, how much you used it this past week. Put it down and out of reach. For some of you, that will be so, you carry your phone around everywhere. So put your phone down. Look people in the eye. Look people in the eye when you're talking to them. Turn the TV off. Turn the TV off when people are talking to you. Lock in. you want to grow in your love for people this week, then give them your full and undivided attention, as if they're a human being that deserves to be seen and heard, because they are. 2, be curious. We are all experts at noticing what makes us different from other people. We're all experts there. And so from there, then we judge, or we turn our differences into competitions or even virtues. And we do that so that we can come off better than other people. We judge our spouses for not doing something the way we would have. We judge friends when they don't agree with our position on a political issue. And we hate people who would vote for a different party. We judge people for making different choices than us. We judge coworkers for not doing their job as well as us. We judge neighbors for not taking care of their house or yard as well as we do. We judge other marriages or families because they don't happen to interact the way that our family interacts. And I could go on. But what if we decreased our judgment of others and we increased our curiosity of others? What if we decreased judging people? What if this place, this family we call Seven Marks, was a judgment-free zone? You just knew it. That's just how we roll in here. There's no judgment here. Instead, we are curious about what God is doing in your life. How is he transforming you into the image of Jesus? How about that? How crazy would it be if we became really curious about each other? Now, I know I talk a lot about my Thursday morning men's group, but one of the things I love is how, through questions, we are finding out more about each other. And I will tell you, the more questions and the more we find out about each other, the more curious we are getting about each other and what Jesus is doing. Look, there are 7 billion image bearers of God walking the planet. So let's stop being judgmental and let's start being more curious. All right, and 3, be open to influence. So practice being fully present with people, be curious, and be open to influence. If we're going to have an authentic relationship, you and I, and if I'm going to be open to being changed by you, then I'm going to have to open being influenced by you. When I'm unwilling to be influenced by you, unwilling to be changed, then what I'm doing is I am keeping you at arm's length. Like I don't want you in. Now some of us want to do all the influencing, right? But if we want to be influenced by others, we have to be open to that. Now, as a follower of Jesus, sometimes we get weird about this, honestly. Because some of us are raised like you don't want to hang out with that person. Like you don't want to be around that person. Now listen, there's legitimacy in that. Okay, there are, in the areas of what I believe and my core values, right, I don't want to be influenced in a negative way away from Jesus. Okay, that's not what I'm talking about. But there are people in my life that do not know Jesus that I love. And they love me. And I gain so much from them. They influence me in profound ways, in very positive ways. If people are what the Bible claims, image bearers, and they are, then each person has gifts that we can receive. Whether or not they're a follower of Jesus or not, no matter how different they are from us, loving people well will require us that we approach them as if we are open and not closed. So be open to influence. Emotionally healthy followers of Jesus get better at loving others. So I'm going to finish this series the way I started. You cannot be a spiritually mature follower of Jesus while remaining emotionally immature. You can't. The cry of your soul are your emotions, and they are giving you significant, important information for us to pay attention to. So pay attention. Sit with it. Understand you got some stuff from your past that you deal with. Forgive if you need to so that you can move forward. Understanding you have limits, it's okay to say no. It's okay to draw some parameters. And then live surrendered to the Holy Spirit. Through him, you will be able to love and you will grow into an emotionally healthy follower of Jesus.